Welcome, I'm Mel Hall. I'm from National Parks and Wildlife Service Greater Sydney Branch. You're standing in it. So this is... Oh, I can sit down there. This is Greater Sydney. For those of you who are not familiar, we are right now about there. You can see Port Jackson coming in. National Parks manages 51 reserves or sites. Now, that a site can be Cadman's Cottage, which is quite tiny. We don't do pest control there. But we do have a couple of big reserves or contiguous or almost contiguous reserves in the north and in the south. So we do a suite of control programs across what some might call peri-urban, but in some instances I call urban. Some of these linear reserves have... Well, I really wish I could do the pointer. Nope. Some of the linear reserves have 6,000 to 10,000 residents adjacent them. And we have been using 1080 ground baiting predominantly to control foxes in a number of key locations for conservation projects. We've been successfully using 1080 since 1997. We started trialling 1080 and have ramped it up and worked collaboratively in a number of instances with councils as well. And just in the last 2 years, we have started aerial baiting in the two bigger reserves, north and south, to protect threatened species assets. Deer control, and we have a long-running control program on deer in Royal National Park down to the south. I've got a little case study about that if we get time to get to it. Otherwise, out in Western Sydney, we have the Cumberland Plain Reserves. Now, they're a suite of small reserves gradually being where the landscape is changing from market gardens, small farms, through to urban development, and a city the size of Canberra is going in out there as well for the new airport development. We do aerial control in Royal National Park. The rest is specialist ground shooting. So ground shooting with silencers and thermals. Rabbit control for sometimes social pressures, but also for threatened species conservation, particular threatened plant programs or TEC programs. The rabbit out to the northwest is not a rabbit, it's a hare. We don't tend to have rabbits out there. That particular location is a feral predator-free area. That's a new way of managing that Parks is dipping our toe into. We have a feral predator-free area, a small fenced area out there where large herbivores and foxes and cats are more the pressure, but we managed to shoot one fox shoot one hare in a nighttime operation out there to declare it now small herbivore-free as well. Pigs come and go, so our programs for pigs are reactive and based on biosecurity rather than conservation benefits. These little piggy item icons are from recent data. We have had a pig, again I can't reach, we have had a legitimate pig in Lang Cove National Park, which is one of these tiny linear ones along a river here. It was, if anybody knows Sydney, it was first reported by a Chinese gentleman living in Pimble. Pimble's quite an upper-class suburb. It was legitimate, and we, with the help of local land services, dispatched that one. Feral goats, again, both biosecurity. They have an eradication target in Greater Sydney. They pop up. They're largely either seeded or released or leaky fences from private properties. We have just commenced an aerial control program for goats out in Golgoa, which is a narrow gorge reserve. We can't legitimately get in there really with ground shooting, but aerial shooting proved effective in knocking out 7 out of 8 goats. I'll zoom back in to, actually, if I just go back. North Head is, if you flew into Sydney, even if you don't know Sydney, you probably circled over the heads. North Head is the 100 hectares of national park and probably another 100 hectares of other tenure on the north side of Sydney Harbour. And it is It's surrounded by urban areas. It's a headland. The pinch point into the headland is the Manly Corso, highly urbanised area. So we'll just focus in a little bit as a bit of a case study on this one. We have two endangered populations, a bandicoot population and a little penguin population. The local community love these populations, and we are throwing effort into making sure that they persist in the environment for the next 100 years. It's also a legislated area of outstanding biodiversity value. It's a leaky environment, but we have a zero predator tolerance on the headland, and our stakeholders agree with that approach. National Parks does the fox control across the majority of the headland. Other partners do play other parts in terms of monitoring threatened species or managing their part of the landscape, but we do the fox control. With the exception of just off park, council has done some shooting programs. We have a business as usual approach up there of cyclic 1080 baiting every 6 weeks, and we have a permanent array of monitoring cameras. So we let the cameras do our work, but then we work to a response plan. You don't really need to see the details of the response plan, just know that we work to a response plan. And that response plan gets triggered if we get a report, a confirmed report of fox activity on the headland, or where we get suspicion of predation. So the seagull picture there, nobody, you know, it could be a few things that killed that bird, but what we do is we send carcasses pretty promptly to Taronga and the Australian Registry of Wildlife Health, and they do a necropsy for us and confirm whether we're looking at a fox or a potential cat or something else. So aren't we lucky or not lucky? Just 2 weeks ago. every year we expect an incursion. You can see here the environment of North Head. There's a faint green line through there that indicates the outside of this green line is park. Then we have the Sydney Harbour Federation Trust managing this land in here. There's a water treatment plan. There's the Australian Institute of Police Management. And just off park, some of these little green patches are council-managed land, or there's a big holding by the church, have a massive bit of a state that is very fox-friendly. So just as an example, run you through what's happened recently. As I said, every year it's a leaky environment. We expect foxes to be moving in and out, and in any 24-hour period, a fox could be there or not there. But we need to protect our assets and respond in a sensible way. So as example, on the 18th, down here at quarantine station, the orange circle number 7, we had a report of a dead bandicoot. It took us a couple of days to get that bandicoot necropsied. Yes, it confirmed we were dealing with a small dog or a fox. Our standard monitoring is to check our cameras once weekly. As soon as we get an inkling, then we go to daily monitoring. So our daily monitoring then showed us that we had had a fox. Our standard monitoring showed us we'd had a fox active from on the night of the 18th. The images of that fox, in most circumstances, it's at a good trot and a canter, and it travelled well across the headland, was picked up at 5 locations. Then we had a period of no activity, and then on the 25th, again, we had 5 detections. Based on that confirmation that we definitely have a fox active on the headland, we then moved to, we changed our bait type, our 1080 bait type, and we set soft jaw traps. And of course, soft jaw traps can't be set even across 200 hectares in 5 minutes. So we set our soft jaw traps where we'd had high levels of activity in just those 2 events. And we were lucky. In previous events, it's taken us 3,500 trap events to catch a particular fox. We've got a very good trapper, but we were fortunate. We got it first night. And another thing, though, had we not got that fox, this is a highly politically pressured. This is a highly pressured environment. We get a lot of political pressure to throw stuff at it. The lesson we have learnt is no, allow the technology and the experts to do their work quietly and steadily. How we would use this data if we got pressure to stand up a sniper, and we have used ground shooters to good effect, then Guy, who's clever with the science in my team, runs a little activity time. So we know that it's pointless us standing up a shooter unless we get some activity in our open space areas where we actually can pull a trigger. And we, instead of sending people out to sit in the cold and dark for forever, we can target our timing. So these are just ways that we use simple raw data to inform our on-ground operations. I don't come from a research organisation, I come from an operations team. Our camera monitoring in this particular instance did allow us to identify an individual on a set of the images. The fox had a particular marking, and the fox that was dispatched had the same marking. Lessons learnt, do not jump to conclusions. We could have had two foxes moving around. So what this triggers, though, is that we then went... We can drop back to business as usual monitoring. Oh, sorry, we can drop that back to our daily monitoring and see if we get more triggers. We didn't, and then we did. Well, we sort of did. On the 29th, so we didn't pull our traps in, we just closed them, leave them in situ. On the 29th, somebody sighted a fox, but it's unverified. The description's a bit... It sort of looked like a dog with a tail. So again, we allow the cameras to do the work for us and just hold firm to we're going to daily monitoring, let those cameras give us information, and then we can target our control. We let our people sleep and the cameras do the work. If anyone's coming to the site visit on Friday, we can give you an update then. We haven't seen the camera. We haven't seen any fox activity on the cameras in the last two nights. Look, I'm going to stop there because I've got 2 minutes until we finish on time. I did have some stuff around the aerial shooting in Royal that I could have spoken to, but the previous York Peninsula talk sort of hit most of our key messages on the head there. We've got an international airport. That's about the only way I could trump you guys. So 1 minute 20 to go. Well, let's give people
a little bit more because Graham finished a bit early.
So. Oh, okay. Well, look, what I could just I can do a speed date version of aerial shooting. Let's not look at the data. This is urban. This is where if you are pondering whether you can successfully do an aerial shooting program, you potentially can. We use a thermal spotter and a thermal scope in our work. Our challenges along the way are always ensuring safety and our agency's reputation. It could be undone very quickly by a wrong move. It's a high-cost program, not in terms of helicopter time, but in terms of we pay the police overtime to come and do park closures, as well as a lot of staff to close our shoot zones. And, you know, we have to seek permission to fly in that controlled airspace. We work these animals within 100 metres of a suburb that abuts into the park. We have a cabin community. We ask them to leave. We don't have to pay them, unlike the York Peninsula, but we ask them to leave for the weekend for us to be able to successfully shoot. And we've shot on doorsteps in that particular cabin community area. I think this is our success story. It's an ongoing program. It's a knockdown program, not an eradication program. but in, so we did ground shooting from 2001 onwards. We started aerial control in 2020 when there was political appetite for it. We made the cover of Sporting Shooters magazine, and that photograph is taken from a helicopter that was flying alongside of us. That's our shooter hanging out with his silenced firearm. So we really were under... Everything we do in Sydney has the media and the public on top of us. And at the time, social media, of course, there was a flurry of social media opinions about an aerial control program. People loved their deer in these close communities to the park. They were their deer. How dare we control them? But in reality, there was a social media explosion. We probably got less than 10 letters and direct phone calls. I think one or two letters to the minister. And we were able to respond to them. And most of our complaints were sensible. Most of them were just, we disagree and we agreed to disagree. It didn't stop the program. Over the short period that we have been doing aerial shooting, the community has growing faith and confidence in the National Parks operation because we haven't had any major catastrophes. By 2023, our complaints have been shifting from park staff as well as neighbours to, we have to mow the lawns, we have to buy a lawn mower. On park, we now have to maintain our picnic areas where once deer suppressed the grass to the point we didn't ever have to mow. And we never get complaints about the shooting, we get complaints about the helicopter flying at 7 in the morning because we need to start early because we've got that thermal gear, it works best in the cool. So I'll just finish with May 2024, our last aerial shoot. We've got another one next week if you want to stick around. The manager was happy. Deer numbers are reducing as a result of this program. Ground shooting, they'll just stay the same. And this is what success looks like in an urban area. No people were located in the closed areas. No staff were confronted. And there's been little, if any, social or media coverage.